So we are going to finish The Sound Machine by Roald Dahl from yesterday. This is going to take another two videos. I tried to record a second half and recorded for too long. Right now, from my phone, YouTube will only allow me to publish videos that are shorter than 20 minutes. So I'm going to try and keep my eye on the time and keep this first video to about 10 minutes. This will be the first video of four projected YouTube posts for today. And let's get started. "And that machine on the table there," the doctor said, "is going to allow you to hear these noises. It may. Who knows? So far I've had no luck, but I've made some changes in it, and tonight I'm ready for another trial. This machine," he said, touching it with his hands, "is designed to pick up sound vibrations that are too high-pitched for reception by the human ear and convert them to a scale of audible tones. I tune it in almost like a radio."
"How do you mean?"
"It isn't complicated. Say I wish to listen to the squeak of a bat. That's a fairly high-pitched sound, about 30,000 vibrations a second. The average human ear can't quite hear it." Pardon me. "Now if there were a bat flying around this room and I tuned it in to 30,000 on my machine, I would hear the squeaking of the bat of that bat very clearly. I would even hear the correct note, F sharp or B flat, or whatever it might be, but merely as a much lower pitch. Don't you understand?" The doctor looked at the long black coffin box.
"And you're going to try it tonight?"
"Yes."
"Well, I wish you luck." He glanced at his watch. "My goodness," he said, "I must fly. Goodbye, and thank you for telling me. I must call again sometime and find out what happened."
The doctor went out to close the door behind him. For a while longer, Klausner fussed about the wires in the black box. Then he straightened up and in a soft, excited whisper said,
"Now we'll try again. We'll take it out into the garden this time, and then perhaps the reception will be better. Lift it up now, carefully. Oh, my God, it's heavy." He carried the box to the door, found that he couldn't open the door without putting it down, carried it back, put it on the bench, opened the door, and then carried it with some difficulty into the garden. He placed the box carefully on a small wooden table that stood on the lawn. He returned to the shed and fetched a pair of earphones. He plugged the wire connection from the earphones into the machine and put the earphones over his ears. The movements of his hands were quick and precise. He was excited and breathed loudly and quickly through his mouth. He kept on talking to himself with little words of comfort and encouragement as though he were afraid the machine might not work, and afraid of what might happen if it did. He stood there in the garden beside the wooden table, so pale, small, and thin that he looked like an ancient, consumptive, bespectacled child. The sun had gone down. There was no wind, no sound at all. From where he stood, he could see over a low fence into the next garden, and there was a woman walking down the garden with a flower basket on her arm. He watched her for a while without thinking about her at all. Then he turned to the box on the table and pressed the switch on its front. He put his left hand on the volume control and his right hand on the knob that moved a needle across a large central dial, like the wavelength dial of a radio. The dial was marked with many numbers and a series of bands starting at 15,000 and going all the way up to 1,000,000. And now he was bending forward over the machine. His head was cocked to one side in a tense listening attitude. His right hand was beginning to turn the knob. The needle was traveling slowly across the dial, so slowly that he could hardly see it move. And in the earphones he could hear a faint spasmodic crackling. Behind this crackling sound, he could hear a distant humming tone, which was the noise of the machine itself, but that was all. As he listened, he became conscious of a curious sensation, a feeling that his ears were stretching out and away from his head, that each ear was connected to his head by a thin, stiff wire like a tentacle, and that the wires were lengthening, that the ears were going up and up toward a secret and forbidden territory. A dangerous ultrasonic region where ears had never been before and had no right to be. The little needle crept slowly across the dial, and suddenly he heard a shriek, a frightened, piercing shriek, and he jumped and dropped his hands, catching hold of the edge of the table. He stared around him, as if expecting to see the person who had shrieked. There was no one in sight except the woman in the garden next door, and it was certainly not she. She was bending down, cutting yellow roses and putting them in her basket. Again it came in a throatless, inhuman shriek, sharp and short, very clear and cold. The note itself possessed a minor metallic quality that he had never heard before. Klausner looked around him, searching instinctively for the source of the noise. The woman next door was the only living thing in sight. He saw her reach down, take a rose stem in the fingers of one hand, and snip the stem with a pair of scissors. Again he heard the scream. It came at the exact moment when the rose stem was cut. At this point, the woman straightened up, put the scissors in the basket with the roses, and turned to walk away. "Mrs. Saunders!" Klausner shouted, and his voice was high and shrill with excitement. "Oh, Mrs. Saunders!" The woman looked around, and she saw her neighbor standing on his lawn, a fantastic arm-waving little person with a pair of earphones on his head, calling to her in a voice so high and loud that she became alarmed. "Cut another one! Please cut another one, quickly!" She stood staring at him. "Why, Mr. Klausner," she said, "what's the matter?" "Please do as I ask," he said. "Cut just one more rose." Mrs. Saunders had always believed her neighbor to be a rather peculiar person. Now it seemed that he had gone completely crazy. She wondered whether she should run into the house and fetch her husband. "No," she thought. "No, he's harmless. I'll just humor him." "Certainly, Mr. Klausner, if you like," she said. She took her scissors from the basket, bent down, and snipped another rose. Again, Klausner heard the frightened, throatless shriek in the earphones. Again, it came at the exact moment the rose stem was cut. He took off the earphones and ran to the fence that separated the two gardens. "All right," he said. "That's enough now. No more. Please, no more." The woman stood, holding the yellow rose that she had just cut, looking at him. "I'm going to tell you something, Mrs. Saunders," he said. "Something that you won't believe." He put his hands on the top of the fence and peered at her intently through his thick spectacles. "You have, this evening, cut a basketful of roses. You have, with a sharp pair of scissors, cut through the stems of living things, and each rose you cut screamed in the most terrible way. Did you know that, Mrs. Saunders?"
"No," she said. I certainly didn't know that."
"It happens to be true," he said. He was breathing rather rapidly, but he was trying to control his excitement. "I heard them shrieking. Each time you cut one, I heard the cry of pain. A very high-pitched sound, approximately 132,000 vibrations a second. You couldn't possibly have heard it yourself, but I heard it." "Did you really, Mr. Klausner?" She decided she would make a dash for the house in about 5 seconds. "You might say," he went on, "that a rose bush has no nervous system to feel with, no throat to cry with. You'd be right, it hasn't, not like ours anyway. But how do you know, Mrs. Saunders?" And here he leaned far over the fence and spoke in a fierce whisper. "How do you know that a rose bush doesn't feel as much pain when someone cuts its stem in two as you would feel if someone cut your wrist off with a garden shears? How do you know that? It's alive, isn't it?"
Yes, Mr. Klausner. Oh, yes, and good night!"
And quickly she turned and ran up the garden to her house. Klausner went back to the table. He put on the earphones and stood for a while listening. He could still hear the faint spasmodic crackling sound and the humming noise of the machine, but nothing more. Slowly he bent down and took hold of a small white daisy growing on the lawn. He took it between thumb and forefinger and slowly pulled it upward and sideways until the stem broke.